Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to another seminar in the York Heritage for Service seminar series, which I'm sure you all know now has been running for about 4 years. And we're now at the point where we're getting a Yours event almost every week during term time. And this term has been the first term, I think, where we have that. And we also have this term, I think, also for the first time, international speakers as well as speakers from our own countries. And that's what we have today. And it's also not a coincidence, actually, that we're having this talk on this day, 25 years almost to the day since the Berlin Wall came down. And I met Leo some years ago, actually. I've known Leo longer than I've known and I got to know Leo really through our mutual interest in Cold War heritage and Berlin and the Berlin Wall. So it's a kind of combination of something, I suppose, that Leo is here and very kindly accepted the offer to come over from Germany to present this seminar today with Polly Feversham. We have a double anniversary, in fact, because we have the 25th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, but we also have the 15th anniversary of the publication of the co-authored book by Polly and Leo, The Berlin Wall Today, which some of you will have seen. It's on one or two of my reading lists, certainly, in contemporary archaeology and heritage fields. So I think without any more ado, I'm not quite sure how they're wishing to play this and who's going first or whatever, but it's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Leo Schmidt from the Framingham Technical University in Cottbus and Polly Feversham. And I should say that Polly very, very welcome back here because she was an alumnus of the Conservation Studies Programme some years ago, and she's also now a member of the Department of Archaeology's Advisory Board, which meets in the department once a year in June of every year. So it's a great pleasure to welcome you back, Polly and Leo. Great pleasure to have you here. So Leo Schmidt and Polly Feversham.
Well, it's amazing that this software seems to draw a number of people. Very welcome to you. Yes, well, the Berlin Wall has actually never been more popular. I mean, these are images from Sunday, 2 days ago, where in Berlin, for 2 days, the course of the wall has been marked by 7,000 lighted balloons at 2 meter intervals. So if you can all compute that, makes 14 kilometers of a ball of light. Every single one of these balloons has been marked with a message of hope and joy and so forth. So it's all been a great festival over the last couple of days in Berlin. We can see here on these images from above how the light strip, as it showed up again, as it did, when the wall was still operational, when astronauts could see, in fact, the solid wall from space because it was so well lit up. On Sunday, Paul Michael opened the new documentation center and exhibition in Danau for us. You can see here that Axel Klausmann, the director of the Berlin Wall Foundation, my former collaborator and assistant in working on inventory as it were of the Berlin Wall remnants in and around Berlin. And I'm happy to bring Axel's kind of regards to you, John, in this moment. But anyway. It hasn't always been a place of joy, as we know. And I think this might be a moment to bring back a few images from, from 1961, more than 50 years ago, to remind us of the background that this place of joy used to be vilified as the Wall of Shame. But just to both to come to a few bits of information how it all came into being, this wall. This is a map of 1946, showing the division of Germany after the Second World War, with bits of Germany becoming part of Poland, and the occupation zone, the American zone, the French zone, the what we call English zone here, and the Russian zone. And of course, these zones then became the Federal Republic of Germany in the West, and the Socialist or Communist GDR, German Democratic Republic in the East. But Berlin was a special case, right within the GDR, but under four-power administration from 1945 onwards, again, but divided into sectors. The Soviet sector, the French, the British, and the American sector. And all through the 1950s, there was no impediment of crossing between East and West in Berlin. You can see here an image of summer 1961, evening traffic passing through the Brandenburg Gate towards West Berlin. Or here, Checkpoint Charlie in 1958, with traffic going back and forth. But this is important information that all through these years, all through the 1950s, Berlin was the one loophole in the Iron Curtain, and anybody living in the DDR could go to West, to East Berlin, because it was also the capital of the DDR, and once in East Berlin, they could cross to West Berlin, and once in West Berlin, they could get out of the communist system altogether. 2.7 million people left the DDR via West Berlin during these years. And for a country with 17, 18 million people altogether, you can imagine what kind of drain, what kind of pressure that put on the communist system. And that's why, I'm coming to a few historical images, the whole thing was built in the first place.
Sie wünschen, dass hier die Bauarbeiter, der Aussteller, die sehr mobilisieren, um eine Mauer aufzurichten. Ja? Hier sind die Konzepte, also ich habe nicht bestimmt, dass sich die Bauarbeiter, der Aussteller, aufgeben in die Bundesfabrik ziehen und ihre Arbeitskraft dafür voll ausgenutzt wird, voll eingesetzt wird. Niemand hat die Absicht, eine Mauer zu errichten.
So it was always rather a place of tension, of political trouble and grief, but we are here to talk about the place, the structure and what became of it. The Berlin Wall was in fact built three times. First in 1961, as we have seen, then again in the mid-1960s, and then again in the mid-1970s. And each time, and we'll go briefly through these three phases, each time the structure was expressed a different situation, different intentions by the East German state. First wall in 1961 was actually meant as a demonstration of power, it was intentionally brutal in its architectural expression, because it was only meant to stay up for a very brief time to make a point, as it were, because the DDR had great hopes of getting a bilateral peace treaty with the Soviet Union that had been promised. And in this case, the whole thing would have been unnecessary within a very short time. It didn't quite work out that way, but we can see that this first wall was really just a shoddy demonstration, not only in the center of Berlin, also only a few kilometers. But right now, the photographers were. So it was, as it were, a demonstration. And it wasn't meant to stay up for a very long time, and it didn't, as we see, because in some places it didn't fall down by itself. So, but in the, in about 1962, the DDR government gradually understood that they were saddled with this thing, that they had to make long-term planning for fortifying this border, and they did it quite scientifically by developing a border zone made up of a series of obstacles, and we read them right from right to left, right is east, because the whole thing was, of course, meant to keep people from leaving the DDR. And there would be first a wall, a signaling fence, various steel spikes to have people who were trying to go that way. Then, one particularly significant element, an anti-vehicle ditch, which only for cars or lorries moving from east to west, because they would run down into this pitch, and only as the last element, the wall facing west, which of course the west saw as the only the main element of this fortification all the time. This is the second manifestation of the wall, fairly nondescript, ugly, but functional wall. In about 1970, the whole background changed again, because the DDR by that time craved international acceptance, and the Berlin Wall had become an embarrassment. So a new design was wanted, and they produced the wall which we know from the 1980s, made up of a series of concrete elements welded and then together made one seamless white wall facing the west, far less brutal in appearance than the older versions. But I think an important aspect of this whole layout is that it's mostly been a propaganda activity in convincing the West and, of course, our own people in the DDR that the whole war was, in the terminology of the DDR, the anti-fascist protection rampart facing the West, protecting the DDR, which is, of course, entirely in contradiction to the actual building, which is, in fact, facing east. And there is this, I'm going to show this little film, which shows the unknown, the non-public side of the wall as one would have seen it from the east in the time when it was still working.
East Berlin in the early 80s. This street leads to West Berlin. Anyone entering this restricted security zone requires special permits. Even visitors of the cemetery seen here on the left. It's been closed off since the wall was built. This is where the barriers marking the border begin. Going further means risking life and limb. Behind what is known as the inner wall is a place an average East German citizen may never enter. A heavily guarded strip of borderland. This is what it looks like at the start of the 1980s. The fortifications are continually reinforced and expanded. The area along the restricted zone is patrolled not only by soldiers, but also by the East German police and other watchful agents. Preventing people from fleeing communist East Germany is an elaborate and expensive operation. Two soldiers guard a 200-meter stretch of border here. In total, there are 12,000 border troops posted in Berlin. The next obstacle is a signal fence. Touch it, and a silent alarm goes off. Soldiers in the watchtowers can immediately see where the alarm has been triggered. Would-be escapee doesn't know it, but the guards are already aware of what is happening and where. The guards in the tower can alert other troops along the border and direct their operations. At night, the no man's land around the border is lit up bright as day. In the west, this area is known as the Death Strip, a place where East German border guards will shoot to kill as a last resort to prevent an escape. The Berlin Wall claims 136 lives. The Church of Reconciliation is surrounded by the Death Strip. The wall separates the church from its parish, most of which lies in the west. In 1985, the East German regime demolishes the church. One possible reason is that it obstructs the guards' view of the border. Tank traps prevent escapees from breaking through, but also the guards. On the other side, a carpet of steel spikes 14 centimeters long seriously wounds anyone who steps on it. East German border guards call it asparagus board. Westerners nickname it Stalingrad or Stalin's lawn. The ground is smoothed regularly so that anyone trying to flee across it will leave a mark. And finally, the notorious Berlin Wall, 3 meters 60 tall, the last insurmountable barrier. The side of the wall facing West Berlin is still part of East Germany. Openings used by the guards to inspect the other side need two separate keys to unlock. One person alone cannot open them. At strategic intersections, the East German regime leaves weak points in the reinforced concrete barrier, so its tanks can break through to the west in the event of a war. Nearly everyone in the world is familiar with this view of the wall, looking from the west. Initially, observation platforms are built for West Berlin's police, later for tourists. This view at Bernauer Strasse shows that the sophisticated containment system in Berlin is far more than a wall.
Right. Well, 25 years ago, the wall fell, was largely demolished within a very short time, and it can be argued that this act of destruction actually turned it into a heritage place, a place of cultural significance with many, many different aspects. Which I think is another topic.
Hello. I'm going to talk about the sort of airy-fairy aspect of the wall. I thought it was about the integrity of it, didn't it? It wasn't really just the systematic destruction of the wall, mainly in 1990 and 91, that was responsible for the disappearance, because millions of fragments were hacked out of the concrete by so-called wall peckers. Do any of you have any? Anybody got really burning? An army of souvenir hunters attacked the concrete to prove their part in the end of the Cold War. And ironically, the war, which has so long been a metonym for the global conflict between capitalism and communism, was in the very process of its destruction transformed into a capitalist commodity. And for a time, these fragments, these perfect symbols of communism, were sold a significant amount in auction houses and stores throughout the world. Like relics, really, relics of the Titanic or pieces of the True Cross, both having very strong associations with death, these little lumps of concrete represented the freezing of an historical moment. And the souvenir functions in quite a complex set of ways. It's often soaked in poignant meaning. And there really are some tangible aid to remembering. And taken home and displayed on. They're taken home and displayed on tables and mantelshelves. The events they witnessed can be seen precariously from a position of safety and distance. They're paralyzed in the layers of meaning and memory that cling to them. Removed from their ritual situation, they can often seem banal or insignificant, but through their former context, they can become particles of history, and through them we can interact with the past. And comparisons have often been drawn between the French Revolution of 1789 and the events of Berlin 200 years later. The collapse of the wall was the greatest symbolic event in Eastern Bloc Europe, thus as the storming of the Bastille was in revolutionary France. And there are very strong similarities between the two. In both, the rage of the people was set loose upon the monument. They were both very, very rapidly demolished, and their fragments became souvenir. Particularly in the Bastille, they were incorporated in jewellery, very fashionable to have necklaces and earrings and bracelets made of fragments of the Bastille. And the Berlin Wall now exists as a rather pathetic ruin. And if a building or structure can be said to embody memory, then a ruin, as the Romantics knew only too well, has an infinite capacity to do so. In fact, it's a kind of paradox between two forces. Between dissolution and the system. And here we have Tintin Abbey, which couldn't be further removed from the ruination of the wall. And it begs the question of how important beauty is in deciding whether to preserve or not to preserve. And Georg Merch, who's a very eminent German conservationist, wrote, "For too long, buildings seem to be automatically regarded as beautiful objects, but it's clear that whole tranche on our inventories are aesthetically meaningless and can even be horrible, but their horribleness is invented, and that is the thing that's important." So even though the wall has very little to recommend it aesthetically, it's still a fascinating multi-layer document which played a pivotal role in its nation's history. It was a defining monument of the 20th century, and it was pretty much ignored for years because of its associations and because of its appearance. And the little remains of the wall today belongs to that rather strange, haunting ruin group, which might include the two-day landing sites, the U-boat pens, from the Apollo launching pad, or indeed here we have the Atlantic Wall. They're all historically significant, but aesthetically completely meaningless, and there's lots of reasons for their existence. And they bring to mind Shelley's amazing poem, Ozymandias, "Look on my works, you mighty, and stand." The Berlin Wall was really quite extraordinary. Unlike other notable historical walls, the Great Wall of China, for example, or Hadrian's Wall, it was built not to keep people out, but to incarcerate them. It was a kind of ghetto wall on a very, very grand scale. And the conservation scheme was that it was a thing so unique and so bizarre that unless the hard physical evidence was protected, future generations might well find it almost impossible to believe that it could exist. And I'd just like to say a few words about the ideas of memory and oblivion in this context. Memory is very much place supported, structures are indeed some harvest of memory. And it might be said that the task of the conservationist is to guard memory against oblivion, and whether through letters, paintings, structures, souvenirs, the more traces of the past we protect, the richer and deeper our understanding should be. So we return to the fundamental value of material traces, the raw evidence, and whether they're venerated or cherished, neglected or ignored, the way we treat them sheds light on collective identity, which is often more felt than articulated. And the idea of collective memory was promoted by the French sociologist Maurice Hunter. It is a testimony of a group's shared history. Because memory is never static, it's reformed with every generation. And the way that it's promoted or suppressed gives us an ever-changing perspective on the past. So basically, memory is a construct of our own time. And monuments and buildings are full of information about cultural identity. And so anyway, the act of preservation is in itself a political act. And from this realization, it's a small step to awareness of how memories can be manipulated. And buildings, of course, are prime targets for this, particularly if they harbor bad or unpleasant memories. Because the first reaction to bad stuff is to obliterate, to annihilate, to forget. And the fall of every Chinese dynasty suggested that the destruction of public monuments, the dissolution of the monasteries under Henry VIII, and where communism fell, statues of Lenin throughout Europe came popping to the ground. Because destruction helps to soothe the pain of remembrance. And those who wish to preserve sites of negative or unpleasant memories, such as the war, are often accused of prolonging unhappiness, of keeping wounds open. But this raises the question of whether a nation's psychological health requires some dialogue in an unmentioned past. And if we believe that a responsible society must be able to live with the shameful as well as the worthy aspects of the past, then it could be said that painful remembrance should be acknowledged by conserving those uncomfortable monuments. Some Nazi concentration camps, for example, have been preserved. Auschwitz is now a World Heritage site, and Hiroshima, because forgetting the annihilation is part of the annihilation itself. Now, the weight of grief carried by the Berlin Wall is in no sense comparable to that borne by the Nazi regime, but nevertheless, 136 people died at the war. Dozens more died at the east-west German border. And tens of thousands of families were torn apart. And the city was wounded, in fact, tragically wounded. And from the very beginning, the war was seen as both symbol and metaphor of division, of incarceration, and ultimately of failed ideology. And perhaps its greatest failing was to shut off the east from ideas, from debate, from change and from initiative. It was much a temporal barrier as a spatial one. And somebody said to me once that going from the west to the east was like leaving a technicolor film and walking into a black and white one because the contrast is so radical and so extreme. And an invidious culture of surveillance permeated every facet of life. And perhaps a truer cinematic articulation of that is that amazing film called The Lives of Others, which was a brilliant explanation of life in the art. So, maybe for
you. Well, the situation brought a problem after the wall has been pulled down for several years. people in Berlin, in Germany, simply want to forget about this whole thing, but it didn't quite work like that. So anyway, rather more like 10 years after the fall of the wall, there was a drive towards memorialization. And one of the areas, one of the places that memorialization was found its strongest expression is Gernauerstraße, an area in north of the city of the center of Berlin, a long street which had survived the war quite well as far as the buildings were concerned, tenements on both sides of the street, six-story houses and so forth. But the southern side of the street belonged to the communist sector, but the street and even the pavement in front of it was already West Berlin, the French sector, which created an unusual situation that people living in East Berlin simply stepped out of their houses into West Berlin. When this when the communists tried to block this border, this obviously created problems because people simply had to walk out of their houses to be in the West. So very quickly these houses were bricked up, demolished, even to make room for the new border area. And at some point even the church, which we have seen earlier in that video, was demolished to make space in that district. So and all during these years, several people died in Gernauerstraße trying to cross the wall. So with all these memories, it was a place very strong memories, painful memories mostly. It was also the site of the parish of the Reconciliation, to which this church belonged. But the church in the eastern sector, but the parish priest living just on the outside of the street in the western sector. And this amazing man, Manfred Fischer, he is the reason why so much of the Berlin Wall is preserved in the in Gernauerstraße, because when the bulldozers came time and again, he ran out into the street and waved them away, thus preserving a fairly large portion of fragments of the wall. And this was the reason why the first attempt at memorialization, the so-called Berlin Wall Memorial, that was erected in Gernauerstraße, which you can see here, just between two steel walls, as it were, one to the layout of the wall in one section. That was the intention in 1999, that should be it, and the rest could be left to developers. But the demand for memorialization, for memory and explanation was so great that the whole street, which was basically a wasteland, even in 2007, was the place where a landscape of memory was conceived from 2007 onwards. And you can see it here in this aerial view, rather more than a kilometer in length, here before anything happened, and here the situation which now exists. And the main aspect or the main guiding line for this whole area has always been not to reconstruct anything, not to try, as many people suggested, to rebuild the wall and to rebuild the fortifications, to visualize what it was originally, but to keep things as they are, the various elements of especially of border wall and various other elements like light strips, the patrol road, hinterland wall and so forth, but not to add anything to it which could be misunderstood as something inauthentic or misleading. But it has what has been added to it has been there have been visual aids, one might say, to allow people to visualize what the situation was originally, but in a very clear language using mostly coating steel or these brown corrosive steel elements. Those are the additions added to it to make people understand the whole layout. Also, information CUI and archaeological windows to look into all the layers of the whole city. They have been archaeological digs, and they have produced, of course, very interesting insight into the houses which were demolished to make room for the border situation. And one of these houses has been prepared as a part of the shelter to allow people to understand this particular situation that happened here. The border wall was the everything is here represented by steel pillars, as it were, which have this particular quality that if you look alongside them, they will close up and, as it were, allow you to visualize in your mind's eye what it was like that the whole street was blocked up. But on the other hand, as one can walk through them, as Secretary of State Kerry did just 2 weeks ago. So it has this element of engaging the imagination of the visitors. Another element is the visualization of watchtowers. Again, in with this material and in an abstract form, it cannot be misunderstood as an historical remnant, but just as a little sign allowing people to get their bearings in this landscape. But another important thing, a component of this landscape of memory is also the set memorial to the memory of the 136 people who actually died during this year at the war. And they have their faces, their names, their dates are remembered here as a very strong element within this complex landscape of memory. Right. Well, with all these efforts over the years, it must be said that in Berlin, the wall, however, is continually disappearing. There are these individual sections down our path that the East Side Gallery people know about, but all the rest of which we documented hundreds of traces years ago, the rest is gradually going. But at the same time, in the rest of the world, we find that this is hardly measurable, but it shows the distribution of Berlin Wall monuments on the various continents. This is Europe, as it happens, that's the outside Germany. This is Northern America and so forth, Asia. So there are about 120 Berlin Wall monuments at least all over the world, and I think a very unique situation of a building, an edifice which has disappeared in its original site, but has been distributed all over the world in various locations.
It was 15 years after the wall fell before the Berlin Senate began work on the memorial concept because of the reasons we were looking at before, because of uncomfortable notice. And in contrast, interest from around the world was massive. A company called Linex was charged with the disposal of some of the bigger fragments. And what wasn't so, quite a lot of it was ground up used for road work and road construction. There was a huge auction of Berlin Wall fragments in Monaco in 1990, which raised hundreds of thousands of dollars, and very badly needed dollars, with financially struggling DDR. And just where they ended up, in terms of reflects the sort of multifaceted and complex ways in which the Berlin Wall is remembered. There's a fragment of the Ronald Reagan Memorial Library, the Presidential Library, with amazing and spectacular views over the Pacific Ocean. And because, of course, he was the one who made one of the famous speeches of all time, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down the wall. compare the students to Raven Library fragments and the student value. And one, this was a flag section, and one side is grey, which represents the communist side, the other is by a chap called Greg Dawn, who painted it on the other side, the butterfly of freedom, unable to get into the communist state. And then there's another fragment which really represents the military triumphalism in New York, because of the whole history of the camps and the whole fact that we won the first of the Global War in New York. And then finally, religious triumphalism in Fatima, which is a shrine about 100 kilometres north of Lisbon in Portugal, where about 1917, the Virgin Mary appeared to three shepherd's children and vouchsafed three secrets to them. One was a vision of hell, the other was the predicted start of the Second World War, and the third, if you not know, was the collapse of communism. And so this 2.5-ton piece was blessed by John Paul II in 1993. And next door to it is a little plaque which reads, "Thank you, Heavenly Shepherdess, for guiding military freedom with motherly affection." So on that blessed note, I'd like to end, and thank you for the questions we've been happy to try and answer.
Very evocative and interesting talk about the Berlin Wall, its history, and how it's been perceived in the years since 1989. I'm sure there'll be plenty of points of discussion and questions, so I don't have to open it up for questions in the floor. Who would like to start?
I'm really interested in the way that the whole thing was assumed as sort of cockpit significance in like dark perspective. It becomes something very sort of sensational and frightening. And I was wondering if that sort of it makes it hard to understand the role which it would have played in ordinary life in Eastern and Western studies during that period, and whether that's a difficult thing to capture.
It was such a menacing thing, and it had such an effect, and particularly in the East, and it's all very well in the West. In the East, it was really, it was a, have you seen this film, The Last
Wonder?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's a fantastic conversation with my world. But it has, again, like, you know, the energy with huge association with the West, as soon as it's rather popular.
But I also think it's an interesting factor. But if one talks to people who lived in East Berlin while the war existed, how they have learned to ignore the things, or to try to live their lives without the constant awareness of this war. And one of my friends is now the director general of the Foundation for Prussian Castles and Gardens, you know, he trained as an art historian in East Berlin in the 1980s. At some point, he took part in a seminar on European palace architecture of the 18th century. And he did his work on his paper on Charlottenburg Castle. And he said afterwards, only years afterwards, he had realized that, I mean, Charlottenburg Castle, he could have taken a bike on there, you know, but it did not allow this to become a conscious thought. You know? It was just as far away as Versailles or Cassandra or whatever, because it was simply the world ended for them after all, in many ways. And I think this is also a mechanism of self-protection, not to sort of realize this every single day.
I'm struck by the Reagan Museum, because that fragment is a sort of self-justification for a particular kind of thing. That's easy, isn't it? Was there anywhere else within Germany, Western Germany, presumably, where it,
fragments were taken and seen positively in that, in anything like the same way?
The thing is that these Berlin Wall, these full-size segments that are all over the world, they are usually decontextualized by the people who set them up with their own, they're really filled with the ideas and the problems and the hopes and so forth of the people who set them up, you know. And that's the fascinating thing about it, how these Berlin Wall segments become as it were vessels to be filled by whoever with new content. They are like pre-floating things to work with, because there's only the most generalized meaning attached to them, about freedom or whatever. It's fascinating to see how they go all over the world and are used and deployed in this recontextualization that is all artistic in one way or another, or political or religious, as you see. And the interesting thing is that how it even like ambassadors of the Berlin Wall in a particular way, because I think they do bring people to Berlin at some point, because Berlin in Berlin also alone, they have about 850,000 visitors per year at the moment, with a tendency rising. And these are people from all over the world, young people, mostly have no personal connection to the collection of the wall. And then they come to Berlin, and somehow the whole story is linked back to the actual historical site and the events.
Is it the case that within Germany it's sort of too close to home? Because they use it in that way.
Yeah, I think the associations, the mental associations of the war are completely different in Berlin and in Germany and in the rest of the world. Because in Berlin and Germany, it's still the painful memory which dominates. And whereas in the rest of the world, the Berlin Wall has a positive connotation. This is sometimes difficult to explain in either direction, because the perception of the different thing today.
We'll go for Martin and then Sharon. Martin.
Mine was sort of similar to what you said. Talk of memory being the psychological memory of the country rather than the people, and preserving it even though it's painful. And you also talk of the priest who preserved the defended perception. But what was interesting is that he lived on the western side of the wall. I just remember you found that people on the eastern side of the wall wish to get rid of it, whereas the people on the west wish to preserve it. Was there?
No, it's
always the opposite way around.
It doesn't work that way. Interestingly enough,
yeah.
I think my impression is that from all I know, the decision to get rid of the wall has a lot to do with eliminating evidence.
Yeah.
I mean, it was, after all, the border guards themselves who very quickly started dismantling the wall. Our colleagues, as it were, the members of the East Berlin Conservation Authority, there are memos of November, December 1989 saying, now that the wall has lost its function, it was still completely preserved, we have to act quickly and put sections under protection.
Okay.
I've heard people saying, living on the eastern side of Bernard Strasse, that they organized, as it were, groups who wanted to preserve the wall. They were simply overruled. They had no chance. There are many people like this, Paris Prince, who felt this is all going too quickly. By people who wanted to remove evidence and sort of get rid of this art of very, very strange people sometimes.
That leads directly to what I was wanting to ask. Could you talk a bit about those maybe strange reasons?
As I said, it's the Berlin Wall was, for a long time, had been an embarrassment to the government of the DDR, obviously, because they couldn't get rid of it because they knew exactly what would happen if they gave it up. What happened in fact was that the DDR was dissolved within months because they simply could not survive politically and economically without this protective haircut, as it were. I think it's a strange companionship of Eastern and Western politicians who for their own reasons wanted to get rid of this embarrassing thing.
It was a strange phenomenon, which is a nostalgia. People used to get
they were closest to getting across this wall. You know? So there was a huge system of mistrust, which is also expresses itself in the structure. If you look more closely, there is this control room in the center of the test strip, and the light strips with these lampposts. Yeah? And on every single lamppost, one could find, you can see in the photographs, some of them are preserved, a color marking, a red, white, green, white, like a sort of, yeah. And we went there once with a sergeant from the former sergeant of the water group, and he sort of reminisced and said, yeah, this red, white, green, white control limit. It doesn't mean anything, but that in fact it meant to the patrolling soldier on duty, not one step further towards the mess or your colleague with a duty. Yeah. And this is just goes to show the difference between the Berlin Wall and say the Mexican border or the Palestine border. The soldiers who are actually doing duty there, or policemen or whatever, they are not under threat themselves. Because they are in fact, however legitimate may be seen, defending an outside border, and that's a huge difference about the bottom one. It's so weird in its construction.
Yeah. I was going to ask about the mentality. How long would it have taken after the walls were done to deal with the psychological, the social, how long?
There are other pieces of it that are more integrating the data in certain avenues, a road, and moving on, and integrating the starting the road. So do you think that there will be any form of memory of Berlin that is more concrete than say all the small little things about what it would like to be a person living in Berlin and what it would be to rest? Is that too difficult? Or is that, are there still a few more ways that people are remembering Berlin that don't just depend on a memorial?
The memorial this is, I think, an official expression of intent. And I think it's with all, I mean, what do memorials do in the whole context? And Halbach talks about that you need rituals and to produce and to support collective memory. And they have a place, they need a place that kind on us as because the family more certainly in terms of Yamaha and here the memoir, you know, it's whether physical or just in the mind. But I think the interesting thing is how from our point of view, the physical tangible heritage, what traces there are in the real world, sometimes or authentic traces which have survived, but also things we produce to foster that memory. But beyond that, of course, I mean, the physical structures are only props. The main thing is what happens in people's minds and heads and it just helps, you know, to produce sort of echoes of the moment.
Can I see your second question? I
just wonder about this memorialization of physical heritage through physical structure. The difficulty lies surely in the memory experience. And to me, the most affecting part of your presentation tonight isn't the actual physical structure of the wall. In fact, there was a film on a woman dead being carried back from the barbed wire. It's a famous one, and I've seen others before. And isn't in the modern world where we have film and all those gestures, do we need the physical props in the way that we might have been 100 years ago? Because they said that, I just thought it was that slide in the past year. I went to the Marshall Theatre now. I have no personal connection with that theatre tour. I know no one personally who has relatives who are at that place. It's an awful place. But the only moment I felt pretty disconnected from it. The only time I felt connection with it was watching. Which is like a very season, people who are younger than the ones who remember it or know it. But James DeMocracy, a famous scientist, produced a television series back in the 1970s. He actually told family ownership. The final segment in the television series about science was him stepping into a pond with ownership, where he actually took his family at home to the family. And he was very careful to speak to the camera about the perversion of science. The only time in mind that it's actually that anything to do with my full that pond and brought in mind his personal testimony. The physical stuff that you're going to do is your connection. And I just wonder in 200 years' time, the people of Berlin will have no memory or access to that with their relatives in connection to the war. That part will just make a moment of display. Does that make sense?
Well, I don't think you're talking about perpetuity. Every generation has to find their own approach because they construct a place of significance in their own minds. But people come in very different shapes and sizes and needs and so forth. So, what's true for you? The simple fact is, for 10 years at least, the Berlin government tried to do exactly what you're saying. We don't need that anymore because everybody knows what the Berlin Wall was, and that's enough. Mm-hmm. And it didn't work that way. Mm-hmm. It simply didn't work that way. For one thing, the question arises, who owns the Berlin Wall? The Berliners, the Germans, the rest of the world, and everybody has a right to it and to their own take on it. Mm-hmm. The early years after the war, when the Berliners didn't want to talk about it or think about it, people from other countries came and wanted to engage with it, and there was nothing there, nothing on offer. And other groups then started to produce some kind of memorialization, which was so awful that at some point in 2004, 2005, the Berlin government decided we cannot let this go on, we have to do it properly so as to prevent from getting completely out of control. In a sense, it's the public demand has really created this whole situation, the memorialization that exists.
Wondering about the relationship between the wall and the Soviet Union stroke, the Russians first in what they thought of it, the investment by the German government and the symbolism that it started to create, especially when they started to deal with the West, and now how, especially as we talked about how it appears in the German mindset, how it appears in the Russian mindset, not necessarily Russian youth, they may have a lack of knowledge, but the more older generation of Russians, plus I think on that map some of the pieces of the wall have ended up in Russia as well by the look of it. So it's obviously part of their national psyche, but how that's begun to develop, is it different from German perception? Must be slightly different, but how different from German perception is it, and how does it visualize in their memories and the more?
As to the early times, it's very interesting to see, there has been a lot of research in the 90s when the Russian archives are accessible and so forth by American historians, Helen Harrison and others. And it turns out that all through the 1950s, the Eastern communists, Ludwig as their leader, time and again came to Moscow and said, we need to close this border, it's killing us. The Russians time and again said, this is your problem. you cannot close that border, it will make us look quite terrible. Change your politics in the DDR so that your own people don't run away from you. That is Khrushchev's answer to it. And they just, for a long time, between 48 and 1961, they simply refused giving permission to that. In the 1961, they eventually caved in and allowed this, but it was a complicated situation because, as I said earlier, this wall, the so-called wall, is just a propaganda coup in 1961 to put pressure on the West to agree to the proposal of the free city of Berlin, which would have been a new entity and more or less under socialist control. The Russians had in fact promised the DDR party that if this didn't work, they would make a peace treaty between the DDR and the Soviet Union, and the DDR would get control of the access routes, the corridors. And then that was the situation in the summer 1961. But then in autumn 1961, the Red Army ran a military game. This is all in the book about this, because this all came out of Russian archives in the 1990s. Military game called Furia Tempest. And they stimulated this situation. They were giving control of the access routes to the East Berlin. And they said, well, what will happen? The Americans have accepted that, they send a military convoy to on the motorway to Magdeburg. This is denied access. They come with strong reports and so forth, that one thing leads to another. After 3 days, I think they nuclear devices that exploded all over Central Europe, and after 1 week, the Red Army would be at the Atlantic coast in France. Yeah? And then they stopped the game. And no, nothing was ever again said about giving control of the Axis group to the DDR, but they didn't tell the that the comrades in East Berlin. So that's the Russian situation at that time. Today, I think it's very, very complicated. And there's still a lot of research to be done about what this war means to different people. I mean, we have plenty of visitors from Korea and China and so forth, for whom this has a very particular meaning, which is completely different if you have somebody from Argentina or whatever. But it's a very interesting.
And on the other side, I mean, in the West, there was, I mean, very, very little reaction to it. I mean, they thought we were going to have a longer war. And then we really come back. And people were pretty appalled by that. They thought, you know, they're not worried about their, you know, bringing the tanks on the center of the war. And everybody's been aware that we've set that up.
So the stuff to drill down, I think, do you have another question? I know you can.
Sitting in their cars, they couldn't get in. out in the first place. So it's sometimes the irony of this.
Okay, two more, yes. To me, you've painted a very emotive development of the picture, you know, describing this development as a landscape of memories for those people that have been involved and have some resonance with it. The fact that you said that last year there were 860,000 visitors who, I can't imagine many of them have a direct link with it. What's your view that it's actually just maybe becoming a tourist destination?
Yes, I mean, even in Berlin now, only 50% of the population of Berlin have any personal recollection of the war. And it's due to generation change and the influx from people. So, and even more so, the visitors from the outside, it is, well, I think, not quite clear that everybody, who these people are and what they. What they really, what drives them. And that is just Panama Plaza. I mean, there are five major areas in Berlin to do with the war and within this memorial context. And there's Checkpoint Charlie, there's East Side Gallery, Potsdam Platz, and the Brandenburg Gate. And there have been all kinds of surveys about people who go there. And it's completely different groups who go to the different areas, it's different backgrounds, it's different knowledge, different intentions, and it's just very complex.
But the idea of creating this landscape of memory was obviously pertinent at the time, but it's like I say, now it's just people visiting because they know about it, and it's a destination as opposed to something that's tangible to those people.
Yes, it's very much. But I think it goes back to what I said earlier. People all over the world grow up, young people, and have some kind of idea about this thing, about it all. Created in whatever ways, and it's of course different whether you grew up in Argentina or South Africa or in Australia or in the US. But and they come in contact with this phenomenon. It has very little to do with the situation in Berlin, I think, because it's become this sort of free-floating icon. But it somehow brings them to the idea, well, let's go to Berlin and see what it is like. But the motivation is very different depending on their earlier knowledge and how they came into contact with it.
The amount of information at the moment that I was there was 15 years across the world was nothing. I mean, people were always working, learning German, it was absolutely no explanation, no interpretation, tiny board in German, you know, doing nothing. And now it's really so, you know, part of the world comes from
Germany. Okay, final question. A quick comment and a question, if I may. I kept thinking when you were talking. Particularly the questions about or the observations about concentration camps, the limits and the memorialization, some sites of awful memory are just too great. I kept thinking of Fred Westphal, who was a serial killer in Gloucester, whose house was knocked down, the materials taken away, and pulverized. And so nobody could collect remembrance and memorialize that site in any way. The comment. The question is, I'm very, very struck by your final image and the scatter map you have. Thinking of, you know, bits of the true cross spread throughout the world. How are the different elements of all treated? Mostly, the ones I've seen that are still set in the landscape system, whether urban or rural. How often are they venerated in that way? How often are they given that sort of veneration?
There's a book called, there's a book called The Venerable Dead. It takes about, I think, 145 different pieces in history around the world. So that's the only one I can find that's
we could bring them all back together, like the Dresden Kirche.
Yes, I mean, there's probably much more ball fabric outside Germany than there is left in Berlin. But these pieces, because it has always been always taken a big effort to take a turn around on in front of concrete and the place, the foreign country, or the city, of course they are treasured. But the interesting thing is, and this is Lucas probably said, is how they, each of them is recontextualized. You know, because it's rarely, I mean, it happens, but that people simply take the trunk and set it on the ground and that's that. They usually do something with it. You know, it's on put on a pedestal, there's an inscription, you know. I mean, the greater Los Angeles are 8 Berlin Wall memorials alone. You know, in the Regents Library, in the Nixon Library, but also in the public situations, you know. And that, often they are in the museum, sometimes, you know, with people, dummies, climbing over it, and the grunts sitting next to it. It's always, there's one famous one in Fulton, which is, I think, 8 pieces of the wall, and I think a lady, granddaughter of Winston Churchill, she cut silhouettes into them, you know, a male and a female silhouette. It's like almost like running through the wall. Sometimes it's very graphic, sometimes it simply doesn't work.
It's rather sad to reflect as well. Maybe the nearest English equivalent to the red telephone box was this spread back the world and turned into sharing cubicles and garden ornaments.
But it's always is something that happens in that particular place. Gives the particular meaning to the people who wanted that thing, because it was not because of Berlin, but because of the symbol of whatever feeling and whatever they find most important.
Thank you guys so much for coming all the way from New York in your case and Naples in your case here. Yeah. It's been wonderful to reunite as well, 15 years after you published that wonderful book. Is it still in print? Or
no,
you still
get it hasn't been in print for a while.
Based on Bible?
Well, on our university website, it can be downloaded, but the...
Fantastic. Okay, so it's in the office, please send me the link.
And we have this wonderful, couldn't squeeze it into that, we have this wonderful online geographical information system, which where you can find every fragment of the in and around Berlin, and these war memorials all over the world, and you can sort of zoom in and look at these things about just from the link.
Yes, I'll send that little staff obviously to that, so you've got it. Thank you very much for coming. A wonderful presentation. Thank you. Next week, 5:15 for wine, 5:30 the presentation. It's Graham Fair Club next week, and then there's one the following week from Tim Shacker Hall from UCL. So the next 2 weeks we have yours events, and then we try to practice.